the things that you've learned over the years that you would have told yourself as a younger person, as that 17-year-old reporting to the British consulate? Mm-hmm. What advice would you have given yourself at that time that you've learned over your years of experience in touring?
Just keep your feet on the ground. Don't believe what the press write about you. And just stay grounded, really. Enjoy what you do.
Yeah.
Don't get an inflated ego. Because everybody does. When you first start and everybody starts telling you how good you are and how wonderful you are, some people tend to believe it. But luckily we were very grounded. And after I'm in Something Good being the number one record in England, we were brought right back down to earth with our second record that did virtually nothing. I think it got to about number 18 in the chart, and we were all sort of ready to have another number one. And with it not doing well, it made us realise that this business can be very up and down. You know, and if you don't treat people on the way up well, they'll kick the hell out of you on the way down. So luckily our third record, which we'll be doing shortly, was got to number two in the chart. So we came back with a vengeance, yeah.
But
just keep your humility, that's all.
Right. That's great advice. I mean, I think that's good for people in any industry.
Yeah.
You know, whether you're a dentist or an attorney or a college professor, you got to stay grounded and be thankful.
Mm-hmm.
To the people helping you.
Exactly.
Yep. You're going to see them on the way up and you're going to see them on the way down. And I was just going to ask, you know, you brought up the difference between your first record and your second record and the third that you're going to play a little bit off of for us pretty soon.
Mm-hmm.
What was the difference between them? What do you think the real, you know, the difference between the second and the third?
Well, the first record was a great song. And it was written by Carole King, and Carole wrote another song for us. And our management made the mistake of taking it to Mickey Most and saying, you've got to do this as the second record. And Mickey didn't like our management telling him what to do. Because quite honestly, Mickey was he had a good ear for music, he knew what he was doing. And our management didn't know what they were doing. And they were telling Mickey, basically telling Grandma how to suck eggs. So Mickey he said, all right, I'll do this song. But he didn't do a very good job on the production. Didn't double track Peter's voice.
Okay.
Peter needed his voice double tracking to make it sound young and vibrant. He didn't put any reverb on the voice. It was very dull. The record was very dull. And that's why I think it wasn't a hit. It didn't sound as good as I'm in Something Good. It didn't sound as alive. And Mickey proved his point. You know, he was responsible for making us sound good. And the management should just keep the hell out of his business. So he picked the third record, which, as I said, was number two in the charts in England. We did really well over here as well.
And so, before you go on to play one of those songs, I'm just curious, you brought up these awesome technical points about double tracking vocals for that depth.
Yeah.
Adding the reverb, that was like a signature sound from that era. Were you doing like 3-mic drums back then? What was the studio
The first record was done on half track, which is just 1/4-inch tape. We did the backing on one half of the stereo tape, then we did the vocals on the other half of the tape, then we bounced that half track down to another half track on one side, added the double track vocals, and that was the record.
Yeah.
You know, no 4-track even by then. We felt ourselves lucky when we went to 4-track and we had the luxury.
4-track!
Four tracks,
of them.
Fantastic.
Count
yeah, we could
four.
Put the drums on one track. I mean, those things was all in mono as well.
Wow.
So, yeah, we couldn't record in stereo until we got 8 tracks, really.
Yeah. And, you know, for people who have stepped into a modern studio where it's just endless, endless tracks, especially on a computer, of course, you can go until your face.
Oh, yeah, I can make demos in my hotel room, 200 tracks.
Yeah.
You know, just layer and layer and layer.
But
there's no end to it.
The beauty is that you're able to make these gorgeous, chart-topping songs.
And I think half the charm of them was that we played live. We actually played as a band. There was no overdubbing. You know, if one person made a mistake on the record, we had to stop, start again. And I remember when we did Amit Something Good, we were also nervous that we had really sweaty palms. You know, and halfway through the song, you think, oh no, I forget where I am, and you've really got to go for it. You know, I think the first record took us 4 hours to do 2 tracks. Which these days is unheard of, you know. You spend 4 hours getting the sounds right now.
Yep.
Just getting the drum sounds right takes 4 hours.
Well, speaking of great sounds, I'm very excited to hear this next one. I'm sure our live studio audience at WZRD, Northeastern Illinois University, would love to hear it too.
Yeah.
We've got
this particular track was not meant even to be a single. We did it as a filler on our first album. Mickey said, "Do you know a song? We're one track short." So we said, "We're going to do this. We'll do this song and show you what it is." We played it. He said, "Yeah, that's great." So we said, "Are you going to record it?" He said, "I just did." So we put vocals on it, and it was released as an album track in the States. And all the disc jockeys over here liked it so much they wanted it to become a single. And Mickey said, "I'm not going to release it as a single until I get a million advance copies, advance orders." He got the million, we released it, and it was the biggest selling record we have, and it took the least amount of recording time. We recorded it in about 20 minutes, I think. This one's called "Miss Brown, Y'all Got a Lovely Daughter."
Yeah!
All right.
Mrs. Brown, you've got a lovely daughter. Girls as sharp as her are something rare. But it's there. She doesn't love me now. She's made it clear enough. It ain't no good to find. She wants to return. Tell her that I'm well and I'm feeling.